Alert one, this is Eagle One. You're cleared to fire. Splash to zeros. I say again, splash to zeros.
My instinct tells me you're bad news. Did you search him, Webb?
I could tell you the size of his underwear.
He said there was nothing to worry about, that it was just a problem with the cable. Yeah, that's true. I'm not so sure.
You came super fast, Matthew.
Well, Spot the Wonder Dog used to help us sniff out the dogs of the week on Sneak Previews, but this week the poor little tyke worked overtime. He was picking out the dogs of the year, the worst, most disgusting, most reprehensible, most artless, most idiotic, most just plain bad movies of the last 12 months. And across the aisle from me, helping me to pick through the garbage, is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune.
Well, I brought my gloves, Roger, and this is Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. Now, rather than just string together a list of rotten movies, we thought that it might be more worthwhile to examine some of the year's lousiest films in terms of what they reveal about what's wrong with the American film industry. And so we've selected movies that illustrate such problems as the film with a better promotional campaign than a script, the international thriller with a cast of second-rate stars and nothing else. And now Roger begins with a film that he hopes will kill off a major trend in American films, the disaster movie.
Well, my first dog of the year on this program is a truly awful disaster movie named When Time Ran Out. It was made by Irwin Allen, the man who also gave us The Swarm and The Poseidon Adventure and Beyond the Poseidon Adventure. It's easy to tell an Irwin Allen picture. They always lead up to an incredible catastrophe with lots of innocent people falling off of skyscrapers or ocean liners or volcanoes. There's always one guy who ought to know the disaster is coming, but he always claims things are just fine while he's staring straight into the face of impending doom. In this movie, that character is played by William Holden.
John, what's the latest? No question in my mind. She's building up. We'd better evacuate. You sure of that? Just a minute. I'd like Mr. Gilmore to hear that for himself. Here, you talk to him. As I said before, I trust my partners up to a point.
I don't know, Gene. I still say it's ready to blow at any minute.
I think so.
That was James Franciscus handing the phone to William Holden. When Time Ran Out has other big stars in it, including Paul Newman and Jacqueline Bisset, helping a lot of victims creep across a suspension bridge above a river of molten lava. That's basically the same scene as in Beyond the Poseidon Adventure, when everybody had to leap across the blazing oil fire. In fact, the whole movie is made out of basic scenes we've seen dozens of times before, and When Time Ran Out was a major box office flop, leading me to hope against hope that time may have run out on disaster movies, and maybe this was the last one for a while.
Well, you're right, this is awful, and we could see it in just in that scene. Whoever the editor was that let those scenes hang on, with William Holden and Franciscus just staring, has really got, you know, about 10 thumbs. The problem with this film, that we're going to try and view these lousy movies in terms of what they say about the American film industry that's bad, I think this reveals some producers, Irwin Allen being one of them, who have a very low opinion of the audience. They think they can fool the audience and rope them into the same story over and over again. And it's sort of cruel manipulation. And I think what it's sort of is bad for the film industry. When the audience walks into a film like this and they see that there's nothing there but that same old formula, I think they feel burned. I think they feel bad about movies in general.
Finally, they just stop coming back. You know, the French director Godard said the best way to criticize a movie is to make another movie. And this year, the movie Airplane, I think, made us laugh so loudly at disaster movies that we may never have to sit through another one, at least not for the next five or ten years.
That'd be great.
Fingers are crossed.
Okay. My first lousy movie of the year illustrates the problem of an old-time Hollywood actor who persists in making boring old-time movies. The film is The Mountain Men, and the actor is Charlton Heston. The movie is a cornball portrayal of a couple of fur trappers trying to battle the big fur companies and the Indians. This is my nomination now for the worst scene in an American movie in 1980. Fur trappers Charlton Heston and Brian Keefe laughing and scratching in the wilderness. They're just awful.
Henry. Oh, that's good. That's mighty good. Look here, Henry. If I'd have known you was laying there scalped, if I'd have known you weren't dead, I never would have left you, not for nothing.
I know that.
Well, I was laying there, come to all by my lonesome. And Blackfeet was so busy taking off after you, he even forgot to take my rifle. I got back to camp, I seen you was gone.
Just walked the hell out of there.
Takes a lot more than a scalp than I put this child under.
It sure must have smarted some, though.
Well, I guess.
You come in late, you think you've walked into a hair transplant commercial. Charlton Heston controlled this project, even down to the fact that his son wrote it, which leads us to conclude that Heston simply has failed to grow up with American movies. This is a 1950s movie. It's in its look, in its comedy, and in its racist attitude toward Indians. It portrays them in some battle scenes as shuffling freaks in red face. This is a 1950s movie, and unless Heston grows up in his choice of material, he'll always be remembered, sadly, as a 50s actor.
You know, it's funny you mention that, because in 1980, Charlton Heston made not one but two movies that could have been made in the 50s. The other one was another dog called The Awakening, yes, where he plays a mummy hunter, an archaeologist on location in Egypt. And this movie was so old-fashioned, even in its archaeology, he finds a priceless 8,000-year-old tomb of an ancient Egyptian princess. What does he do? Takes a sledgehammer and beats the hell out of it. Get me to those mummies, you know. It's totally ridiculous.
Well, look at the films. A mountain man, a mummy hunter. I mean, this is old stuff.
If he'd been battling an octopus at the bottom of the sea, that would have been his trilogy for the year.
I think that what this really indicates that's wrong with the American film industry is when an old-time star has enough clout that a studio will finance any project he wants rather than looking at the script. And I think that's unfortunate. I think that's what's happening with Heston. Mm-hmm. And I hope he makes better decisions, because this year he was really awful.
He's made some good movies. He's a good actor, but
not this year.
Not 1980. So far, We've talked about a couple of box office flops, but another one of the year's worst films was, however, also one of the year's most successful films. The Blue Lagoon grossed a ton of money at the box office, which goes to prove that 20 million people can be wrong. The Blue Lagoon is a ridiculous fantasy about two pre-adolescent kids who are stranded on a desert island, grow up together, and discover sex. The movie isn't exactly realistic. It makes the shipwreck survival ordeal look like a vacation at Club Med. Visit beautiful sunny the Mediterranean. Brooke Shields and Christopher Atkins as the two love-struck kids there. They became teenage idols in The Blue Lagoon, an escapist, totally unrealistic movie that claimed in its ads to be about natural love. One of the most offensive things about the film is the way it pretends to be so wholesome and natural, while all the time, let's face it, it's exploiting nudity and sexuality. This movie is about as innocent as those old nudist camp documentaries that pretended they were about fresh air and volleyball.
Well, I don't think it's as bad as you think it is, but I will say that you have picked the worst element of the film, which is that holier-than-thou attitude that we are now going to see sex treated in an honorable way. This is plain peekaboo stuff. We're waiting throughout the picture for Brooke Shields' clothes to fall off, and some people are waiting for Christopher Atkins' clothes to fall off. I mean, there's really nothing else there. This is not a tender love story, as far as I'm concerned. It's a bad thriller in terms of what's going on that island, and it also plays peekaboo with sex. So I found it actually a very immature film.
I'll say one thing about this film. They advertised it in Parents Magazine and Reader's Digest, saying, "Parents, send your kids to see all this wholesome, natural sex." I know when I was 13, I would have loved to see this film, and not necessarily for the same reason as the editors of Parents magazine.
Exactly. It's just simply a nudie show. Uh-huh. Well, one of the kinds of movies that I always dread walking into is the prepackaged international thriller, the kind of movie that is made in Europe with a cast of international stars, one from each major country. These films always have dreary night photography, and more thought has gone into the international financing than into the film script. For example, in 1980, we had Ffolkes, with Roger Moore playing a Scottish espionage agent in World War II. Here he attacks some Nazi creeps on board a ship.
Thanks, boy.
Girl.
Look like a boy. You act like a boy.
Okay, I'm a boy. I was hiding in the lifeboat.
If he comes to, slug him. And keep out of the way. Bloody fool.
There you have it, a ferocious battle in wetsuits. I hope you saw it here first. I love that line the young woman says, okay, I'm a boy. Even she's fed up with him. Films like these have no heart, just a couple of action scenes and a sex gimmick or two. This isn't movie making, it's a financial deal, with a film being cast and sold country by country on the basis of its stars. We want to sell it in France, we put in a French actor. You walk into one of these films and you leave scratching your head, wondering how anyone in the entertainment business can make something that contained so little entertainment.
It's so obviously a package. You don't have to be a movie critic to say, I've seen this movie 100 times
right.
before. And as for Roger Moore, he makes a James Bond picture every 2 or 3 years.
Right.
That makes him a big star all over the world. That makes him bankable.
Right.
Then they put him in movies like this where they can advertise him. Everybody knows who Roger Moore is, and that's the package.
Yeah, I think that everybody associated with a film like this thinks they're very clever, the way they work their deals out and the way their advertising suggests it's another Roger Moore film and a big adventure story. Mm-hmm. What they forget is that they're ripping off the guy that made Roger Moore a star in the first place, the average moviegoer. People walk in here and are just totally mystified. They get nothing like what they expected.
Mm-hmm. You know, 2 years ago on our year-end show,
yeah.
the worst member of the dog of the year, 1978, The Wild Geese.
Oh, right.
Starring
Roger Moore.
Another deal just like this one. So,
okay.
at least some of the dogs of the year you hardly ever hear about. And Ffolkes, for example, was a movie like that because it did very little business at the box office. But other dogs are incredibly heavily publicized, and when they collapse, it sends ripples all through the movie industry. One movie like that in 1980 was Can't Stop the Music, an original musical with an idiotic story which starred the singing group The Village People.
Young man, there's no need to feel down. I said, young man, pick yourself off the ground. I said, young man, cause you're in a new town. There's no need to be unhappy. Young man, there's a place you can go. I said, young man, when you're short on your dough, you can stay there. And I'm sure you will find many ways to have a
Well, they advertised this as the entertainment explosion of the year, and it was a bomb, all right. Can't Stop the Music is a musical that couldn't seem to start the music. It's a traffic jam of unrelated characters who all crowd onto the screen and create general confusion. When the movie does occasionally manage to let the village people actually sing, like they did in that scene, the results are okay. But the movie was a major disaster.
Mm-hmm.
Even on opening night, before the word was out about how bad this movie was, the theaters were already empty. Nobody wanted to go in the first place.
Well, I think the problem in the film industry that this film is an example of is the pre-sold package. The guy who made this film, Alan Carr, took Grease a few years ago, an established package on Broadway, and made it a movie, smash hit.
Mm-hmm.
But Grease had a story already established.
Mm-hmm.
He tried to do it again. Take a music group, The Village People, put them in a movie, forgot the script. These are narrative movies. They need stories that make us want to watch the characters.
And another problem was the Village People were very much a trend 18 months ago when the movie was being, when the idea was first being floated. By the time the movie came out last summer, the Village People were over the hill. Nobody really cared, so there had to be something on the screen that they wanted to go see, and there wasn't. They were just hoping the Village People would carry it. That and the promotion. They spent a lot of money promoting this movie, lots of parties, lots of ads. Their problem was they didn't have anything to promote.
Yeah, no script. My next dog is Windows, a vicious thriller with Talia Shire playing a New York woman alone being stalked by a crazed urban weirdo. The secret behind the film was that the weirdo is not a man, but a woman who secretly loves Shire and wants to frighten Shire so badly that she'll stop living alone and move in with her. This provides the basis for a lot of horribly brutal scenes, like this one, where the lesbian psychopath, played by Elizabeth Ashley, has sent a man to intimidate Shire. Naturally, the guy overdoes it.
What is it?
People who saw that scene really felt violated by it. That's very cruel material, and it really has nothing to do with the film's story. A scene like that is inserted into a film just to terrorize an audience. It's not pertinent to the story of sexual obsession. Windows is just a cruel parody of a lesbian relationship, just a pretext for scenes designed to shock us out of our seats.
What made me really feel bad during this film was the fact that since it was so clear who did it, who the villain was, or the villainess in this case, all we were asked to do as the audience was simply to observe this violence, almost as vicarious participants. I didn't like it. I didn't enjoy it. I felt bad about it. Another reprehensible film this year was the penthouse production of Caligula, based on the novel by Gore Vidal, who had his name removed from this film. The movie's director also took his name off. So did the screenwriter. Nobody wanted credit for this bomb, and the movie's distinguished cast of great British actors, they couldn't escape. They were right there on the screen. They looked awfully uncomfortable as they marched through this garbage. Look at them in this scene. Malcolm McDowell, Peter O'Toole, Sir John Gielgud, a roll call of wasted talent, all equally wretched in the story of the collapse and decay of the Roman Empire.
Bind his wrists.
Oh, you must not leave me. You're my friend, my only friend.
I have lived too long, Tiberius, and I hate my life.
Leave us! Both of you!
For a man to choose the hour of his own death is the closest he will ever come to tricking fate. And fate decrees that when you die, Macro will kill me.
I'll arrest him and have him executed.
You can't. He controls you. Anyway, even with Macro dead, how could I go on living with this reptile?
You will respect my friend always, won't you, reptile?
I've always respected him, Lord.
You hear?
Tiberius, you were wise once.
Ah, don't taunt me. I am old.
I've watched you grow into a monster. One by one, I've seen you murder your family, your friends, the noblest men in Rome.
That is treason.
No, it's the truth.
The waste of this movie, what you could do with those actors in a good screenplay. Caligula isn't just artistically bad, it's also offensive in its gratuitous scenes of torture and perversion. This movie makes a real specialty out of castrations, disembowelments, crucifixions, and other forms of torture that the camera lingers over and lingers over, and what a piece of trash.
Well, I think the problem here about the movie industry is that this is an amateur production by a first-time movie maker, Bob Guccione, the publisher of Penthouse magazine. With the collapse of the studios, a lot of amateurs are getting into the movie business, trying to hit the home run. And what they know is exploitation, like a magazine. They know sex and all that stuff. But what they don't know is that a movie needs a solid story. They couldn't recognize
it
if they read it.
I don't really object to the independent production, but this movie seems to me to be after that dream, that unattainable dream that has been around ever since porno came in the 60s. They've always wanted to make a hardcore movie that would make millions of dollars at the box office and would be artistically respectable. And this movie is hardcore, all right, but it's not artistically respectable, and it didn't make millions.
Okay. The Final Countdown, our next film, illustrates a problem with American movies that my colleague here has called the idiot plot. I think I know one when I see one now. A storyline that is so stupid that the only way it can hold up is if every character in the movie is an idiot who can't figure out what's going on. The Final Countdown tells the story of what might happen if there were a big electrical storm in the South Pacific that set up a time warp that transported a modern-day Navy battleship back in time to December 6, 1941, the day before the attack on Pearl Harbor. Would the crew have had the brains to try to prevent the attack on Pearl Harbor? Well, here are some of the confused reactions of the crew.
Captain.
Yes?
Sir, is it possible that this could be part of some secret naval maneuver?
Of course not.
There are a few people who'd like to watch us work under pressure.
What are you saying, Sam?
The Department of Defense sent him out here. Maybe they wanted to give him something to watch.
Now, that makes more sense than anything else so far.
Now, wait a minute, gentlemen. You may be the victims of some kind of joke, whether the Pentagon's behind it, or the Kremlin, or some little green men from Mars. I promise you, I'm as much in the dark about it as you are.
Captain, we're getting something you might want to hear.
In the plot room.
Aye, sir.
The Germans, under Marshal von Kleist, are retreating on the 70-mile front in southern Russia. However, forces under General von Bock were reported 200 miles from Moscow, and long-range artillery fire was heard in the suburbs of Moscow. Meanwhile, in Washington, military circles...
What the hell's going on here?
The battle plans, sir, of the Germans. I think you ought to see these aerial reconnaissance photographs of Pearl Harbor.
Turn that off.
Yes, sir.
That'll be all. You.
It's not Pearl Harbor.
Sure as hell is.
Look at that old battle wagon.
It's a memorial now. It's the Arizona.
This movie has so many dull passages that we have plenty of time to realize that they're not going to stop the war, because obviously history would have then been changed. In other words, it's going to turn out to be either one big dream or, yes, there'll be another electrical storm and another time warp, sending the ship back to the present. Nobody in this picture ever picks up a phone and just calls the president. This movie truly contains a ship of fools.
You know, one of the disappointing things for me, I guess war pictures are out right now, so in this movie they assembled all the ingredients for a war picture and didn't make it. They have a pretty good cast there. Kirk Douglas is the skipper, Martin Sheen. They have that aircraft carrier. Life on board the aircraft carrier in this movie is very fascinating. But then, no war. They invent a time warp. They send the ship way back in time. They turn it around. They bring it back to the present again. It's all anticlimactic.
You're right. It's a war movie without a war, and it's based on a best-selling book. But the book, obviously, just comes across on screen in this picture as a gimmick.
Hold on just a minute, Gene. Here he is, leaping a little belatedly into the balcony, our resident expert on bad movies, Spot the Wonder Dog. We spent the whole program this week on films that were abundantly qualified to be Dogs of the Week, but Spot is here to introduce the Dog of the Year, the single worst movie of 1980, and on this one, I think we both agree.
Go get it.
The worst movie of them all, 1980, was I Spit on Your Grave, an exploitation film about an independent woman who goes on a vacation in the country and is attacked and brutally raped by four men. In this scene, after they've attacked her, they make fun of the journal she's been keeping.
Hey, listen to this, you got some
minutes. What?
Finally, after weeks of self-doubt and much deliberation, she embarked on a temporary leave of absence from everything that formed the fabric of a life. Her hectic daily schedule.
Oh, hectic.
Restless
people who made this film should really be ashamed of themselves, and so should the people who booked it and the people who went to see it. It's really an inhuman, sick film.
This is the film, Roger, that has illustrated a trend we've talked about in a previous show, the trend toward showing independently acting women. This woman goes off on her own to write a book, and she gets hammered for it, sliced up, brutally attacked. Mm-hmm. This has made, for me, the most unpleasant movie-going year in my 11 years as a film critic. This is the kind of movie that did it for me.
Really rough year, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, try to end this on a little happier note. Here's your last warning. One more look at our selections of some of the year's worst movies presented to you as a public service. And here they are. A pretty horrible list, and one thing that all of these films seem to have in common is that they were more gimmicks than stories. Mm-hmm. If movies are going to have a story, it better be a good one, otherwise the gimmick shows through.
Even a bad movie can't go too far wrong if it's about real people doing real things. Well, that's it for this week. Next week on Sneak Previews, we've scheduled a repeat showing of a program we did a few months ago on the alarming success of those films like I Spit on Your Grave that we were just talking about. Films that sadistically exploit the situations of women in danger. We think these films are a box office epidemic, and we'll take another look at them again next week. Until then, we'll see you at the movies. Thank you.